Welcome to Videoville Church. Given that we're living in extraordinary times, that is, we're living in the latter days, the days that Jesus spoke of as being the end of all things, the beginning of the millennium, the time appointed that we would see much tribulation, though many of us will not go into great tribulation, there are those who will, in fact, go into the time of Jacob's trouble, suffer and die. Being that we see all these things coming about and beginning to happen in our generation, the fact that Israel has become a nation, the fact that we have chosen a president who chooses to reject the tenets of Christianity and accept humanism as his ultimate goal, the reality of mammon and man made, that he can choose to use what he wants to and reject whatever he chooses to, we see in these power struggles, these men failing the test that Christianity has put before each and every one of us. And that is Jesus Christ your Lord? Now, I personally like what we're going to do today because I kind of enjoy the idea and the concept of backward masking. I like the idea of reading things forwards and sometimes reading things backwards. I don't really like the idea of taking things out of context, but I like putting things into context. So some of what we're doing may challenge you. Some of what we're doing may surprise you. Some of what we're doing may, in fact, amaze you at how God has so arranged His Word that it fits perfectly for our lives today. We're looking at the book of Psalms, and today we're going to look at Psalm 2. So if you want to, you can look in your Bible. You can probably put on your Bible app and reference it to Psalm 2. Hey Siri, Psalm 2. Or if you're a droid, hey droid, or whatever it is droid uses, Psalm 2. You know, and bingo, bango, bongo. You know, you can start playing with it and start thumbing it, you know, and kind of make your own kind of music. Or you can listen, you can observe, you can see, and you can pay attention to what we're doing. You see, we're not going to go through Psalm 2 forwards. We're going to go through Psalm 2 backwards. So Psalm 2 in verse 12 says this: "Kiss the Son, lest he be angry, and you perish from the way, when his wrath is kindled but a little. Blessed are all those that put their trust in him." I like that. It's kind of like, you know, I need to maybe switch glasses too because I'm going, I can barely read that. That's kind of blurry-eyed to me. Let me see if these are better. Oh, okay, let's try reading that a little bit quicker, you know, kind of doesn't kind of sound choppy. "Kiss the Son, lest he be angry, and you perish from the way, when his wrath is kindled but a little. Blessed are all they that put their trust in him." The one sentence, "Kiss the Son, lest he be angry, and you perish from the way, when his wrath is kindled but a little." We see that God can, in fact, have wrath. Jesus, in fact, we're told, because it's the Son, does have wrath, but a little. Wow! You mean the Son of God might come back with his wrath? There's a lot of teachings about pre-wrath, post-wrath, mid-wrath, and all these other wrathful things. But the bottom line is that we're told to do something first. Kiss the Son. Kiss him in greeting. Kiss him as soon as you see him. Kiss him, lest you be even like it done to Judas, who did kiss the Son, but he kissed him to betray him. Is that what you do today? Think about that while we're reading the rest of it. "Serve the Lord with fear and rejoice with trembling." Wow, serve the Lord with fear. Are you afraid? Well, obviously, probably not. You get to do what you want to do any way you want to do it. At least according to grace, with which you are saved. Isn't that what most people say today? I mean, I happen to know Paula White, you know, Cain, says that she can do whatever she wants to do as long as she's, you know, in the Lord and led by the Spirit and doing whatever she says God has told her to do. Okay. I can't judge another man's servant, but I can tell you this, I'm not following that servant. Sorry, I'll do what the Lord tells me to do, even as she probably does. I know there are other prosperity doctrine preachers that will say the same thing. Hey, God told me to tell the people that, you know, they're going to get $1,000 today, and it's just up to them to have the faith to get it and claim it. Okay, but that's not what I'm going to do today. You see, what I'm going to do is serve the Lord with fear. I'm going to question. I'm going to ask. I'm going to think about it. I'm going to ponder it. I'm going to compare Scripture against Scripture. I'm going to go back to James 1:5 and say, God, help me. I don't understand. And He'll give me wisdom. Be wise now, therefore, O ye kings. Be instructed, you judges of the earth. Now, we're told, you know, about judging and not judging, and Jesus said, don't judge, because how you judge, well, you will be judged. So on the one hand, if you're smart enough to not judge, you're not going to get judged. But if you do judge, guess what? You'll be judged the same way. So there are judges of the earth. There are people that have set themselves up, that have learned the methodology of what God wants to say about judgment, which is to commit it unto God and let Him judge. But the judges of the earth, hey, and the kings, well, now let's become wise. Let's figure out what it is that the kings need to be instructed. Even as we know Mr. Trump, as an anti-president, as a businessman, needs to be instructed in how to get his act together. Obviously, his cabinet, his administration is running like a business, and it's failing miserably. He needs to get his house in order. He's a king of the earth. He needs to examine and find out what he needs to learn and be instructed of the Lord. Thou shalt break them with a rod of iron. Thou shalt dash them in pieces like a potter's vessel. Whoa! Read backwards, that really scares the big Jesus out of me. Because it's like, whoa, even the kings of the earth? Yeah, even the kings of the earth. Even the judges of the earth? Yeah, even the judges. Even you, even me, even any one of us that God could break with a rod of iron. A rod of iron is always how God determines He's going to create obedience among the nations. It says that He would rule with a rod of iron in the millennium. Why do you need a rod of iron? Because people will not listen. People will not obey. We have a perfect example of it today as we see what happens from the first man all the way down to the last man. Do we have Donald Trump obedient unto God, serving Him in fear and trembling? Do we see him acknowledging that God has directed his path? Or is he just doing what he wants to, as he said he would? Even as he said that he will restore America to greatness. Not God will bless America. Not God will give greatness to whom he chooses. But rather, shouldn't we pray that he humble himself today and find salvation and mercy and grace? That would greatness be not made manifest to him if he would do that? That's for you to decide. Because you see, each and every one of us are vessels. But are we going to be broken in pieces? As for me, ask of me, and I will give thee the heathen for thine inheritance, and the uttermost parts of the earth for thy possessions. Hey, God, I want Hawaii. You know, that's what Chuck Smith used to say. And who knows, maybe he'll get Hawaii in the millennium. I don't know. You know, I always tell my wife, you know, that one of the greatest things that's going to happen for her is that when we get to heaven, she's free from me. We're no longer married. But then again, there is the millennium, and there's 1,000 years there. Ugh! Some of you may want to think about that. Will you be married in the millennium? Uh-oh, trouble. But really, what we're saying here is that we all alike need to ask of He who is Jesus, who is the Father. I will declare the decree the Lord has said unto me, Thou art my Son, this day have I begotten thee. Oh, I like that. Today I begot you. Today I begot you. You know, a begotten? You are a begotten son of God in a way, because today God will say to you, you're my son. If in fact you have committed your way unto the Lord, and today you can say that you are doing things His way. Now I know there aren't sons and daughters of God. There are many that are children of Satan because they follow the ways of the world. They follow that with which the world and the God of this world says, money, 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 money. You know, the Trump theme song. Isn't that what greed is all about? He said greed is good. He said Jesus got it wrong. Riches are what God intends for you, even as some of the prosperity pastors laid hands on him and said, hey, you be our Cyrus, you be our king, and we'll pray for you and keep you safe from anything that the Satan will bring unto you. Well, that's not exactly how God does things. You don't just lay hands on a man and say, you're saved. You don't just declare, stand up, and give testimony and say, hey, this man's saved. He's a Christian, you know? And then the guy goes out and commits murder or adultery or greed or lasciviousness or possessiveness, or even leads a nation into despair, or takes a nation down to a place where they're no longer serving the Lord thy God, but serving themselves instead. Because the reality of serving our flesh is one thing we are not allowed to do. We're supposed to choose ourselves for each and every day which way we will serve, whether we serve the Lord, our God, in fear and trembling, or whether we serve the gods of men in blessings and getting accomplishments and getting power and authority to do what we want to do. I mean, you can obviously see that Christianity has an identity problem, because on the one hand, you got people that are standing up and saying, hey, I can speak the words of faith and it will happen. It sounds like a god to me. And unfortunately, in the Proverbs and the Psalms, it says, now you're gods, but you'll die like men. But then on the other hand, it says, work out your salvation with fear and trembling. Now, I kind of like that idea, because then it acknowledges there's someone greater than I am that I have to seek to follow, ask to be led, and allow for God to convict, especially if I am in sin and I find myself dead unto the things of the Spirit. That's the reality of an identity crisis that's going on in Christianity today, and that is an identity crisis that you face even as you seek to follow the laws of the land, as some people have said, and acknowledge that your president is a Christian? I don't think so. Rather, you should seek for yourself to find yourself in the faith than worry about what's going on in the government. That is one of the kingdoms of this world that Satan can give to whoever he chooses. Because after all, in these kingdoms, that is what Satan is doing, using whom he chooses for the end of the world. God allowing this time of the Gentiles to be fulfilled. The Holy Spirit pulling back as evil begins to manifest itself day by day, advancing more so every day in the world. We talked about at the beginning of the year, January 1st, 2017, there would be 1 degree of separation. Now that 1 degree doesn't sound like a lot, because there's 360 degrees in a circle. But 1 degree of separation, depending upon how far away it is, the Lord's return soon, yes, but how far away it is, well, 1 degree of separation by the time it's the end of the year could have you pointing at New York and you're standing in Los Angeles and winding up, dare I say, in Antarctica. 1 degree of separation as it expands outward day by day. So you see, there's an exponential element that is unfortunately happening in the world today. People are going farther to the right, farther to the left, farther into the world, and farther looking up instead. Looking out to Jesus, looking towards the soon return of the coming King. Yet have I set my King upon my hill of Zion. I like that. That's verse 6, by the way. We're still going backwards, you know, in Psalm 2, in case you just caught on and you're catching on. We're going from the Psalm 2 backwards, reading it in reverse, kind of like reverse masking, you know, seeing what the message is. And it says, yet have I set my King upon my holy hill of Zion. There is a King, and it's not Trump. There is a King, and it's not the King of England, the King of France, the King of Luxembourg, the King of your household. As a matter of fact, Jesus is the King of Kings. Jesus isn't only declared a king because in righteousness will he reign, and he will have a kingdom that will be made manifest during the millennial time that Israel has become known for going to have, as it were, the Messiah come and set up his kingdom ruling from there in Jerusalem and New Jerusalem coming down. But there will also be other kings that have in some way manifested the ability today to be treated as a king, ruling in righteousness, ruling in mercy, ruling and governing in a way that is pleasing in the sight of God. And that's what I'd have to ask you today. When you look at these scriptures, do you examine whether or not you're in the faith? And then do you examine to see if someone else is in the faith? Do you sit down and realize that maybe faith isn't just about believing, but it's about conceiving of what God has said and watching it to become true in our own life and in the lives of others. You see, I don't have to do much for my faith. God grows it. God is the husbandman. I'm someone who's supposed to take care of the watering, you know, make sure you get enough water and don't drown it. You know, reading the Word. I'm the one that's supposed to be eating right, you know, kind of like digesting it and chewing on it, you know, and getting all of the volume of the book that's written of Jesus. But I'm not the one that's the gardener. The Father is the husbandman. He dresses out the garden. So you see, there are weeds, obviously, in the garden, and he's taking care of that. There are obviously plants that are more like tares, and they don't dare become too tall or too much of an offense, then God will remove them. But you see, it's got to be God that is doing it, because the time is short. The time is at hand. The end of the world is coming, and the night is coming that Jesus warned us about, when the workmen could no longer work, for the night has come. And that's what I see right now in America today. I see Christians who have gone off the rails for whatever reason, that maybe there was some kind of failing in their life at some point in time. They decided that Jesus wasn't Lord, and they no longer wanted a king, but they wanted to pick their own kingdom and set up their own king, and they now have one. They have anointed him, they have appointed him, and they have declared him to be king. Do you realize that? The Pentecostal preachers that were praying for Donald Trump were not praying for him to be president. They were praying for him to be like King Cyrus. Think about that. Think carefully, Christian, about what is being said here. They want a king, even as Samuel cried unto the Lord and said, "Oh God, they hate me." And God said to Samuel, "No, they want a king like other nations. They want someone to rule them, one man rule, like other nations. They want a king, and they haven't rejected you, they've rejected me." Think about that. You need to consider carefully what Donald Trump is doing now. That is a fulfillment of what some people prayed for him then. They laid hands on him. They prophesied. And I got news for you. It's false. He is not King Cyrus. There is nothing in his demeanor or his manner or even in the declaration of prophecy that God chose Cyrus and said, "By name I have chosen Cyrus to rule over and to supplant Nebuchadnezzar." At that time it had been different Nebuchadnezzar. But to take over that world kingdom. But he called him by name. I'm sorry, but I can't look in the Bible and see Donald Trump's name anywhere in there. But I can see kings that are similar to Donald Trump. King Saul. King Saul was the first king that was declared king over Israel. And we see now that this man who likes golden things and to put his stamp seal of approval on everything he does, Trump, and he wants to be king. He was anointed by some Christians, Pentecostals, I'll admit, prosperity doctrines, I'll admit, prosperity pastors, I'll admit, and a couple of evangelicals, I have to testify to, that they have said he is, hey, the salvation of America. He will make America great again. He will put America first. Now, I don't know if you choke on that, but I do. When I use the word first, I never put America there. I've always been known for, and even my wife will say so, because, you know, she doesn't always like it, but I'll say Jesus is first, last, and always, because you know what? When it comes to bottom line, I don't have to stand before my wife. I don't have to stand before Donald Trump. I don't have to stand before a guillotine. I don't have to stand before anything else. But by God, I'm going to stand before the living God, and I'm going to have to say something. And it ain't going to be America first. Sorry. Wrong answer. Would you like a lifeline? Jesus is the answer. So, dare I say, we have a man who has gone the wrong way. "Then shall he speak unto them in his wrath, and vex them in his sore displeasure." Ouch! I don't like these things. You know, when I read scriptures, I take it personal. I mean, don't you? I mean, don't get me wrong. I mean, maybe you don't take it personal, but I always figured God was speaking personally to me. And I'll be honest with you, you know, I had a hard time for the first, about 10 years of my Christian walk, because every time we got into scriptures that were like the prophet speaking to the nation Israel or some, you know, whatever people they were talking to, I thought God was yelling at me. You know, like, I'm dead. Ooh, yuck. Because I always took everything being said then to me personally. And then, you know, I got involved in a ministry at one time, you know, and that was kind of an interesting ministry. But I got involved with a baby ministry for the first time, you know, at Calvary Chapel. And you know, I mean, for a while, everything was kind of cool. Then when the man went off the rails somewhat, you know, he started preaching, and he started preaching at me. Well, I didn't think at first that it was at me until he started using specifics. Then when he started getting even more specific, I started thinking, wait a minute. I'm innocent. How is this happening, God? And so I had to get really tight and really right with my personal relationship with Jesus. Because when you have, and you're sitting inside of a church, and you have people shunning you, when you have people turning their back on you, when you have people not willing to talk to you because of what the pastor said, you're put into an interesting circumstance because you could get bitter, you could get better, you could get worse, you could become a heathen, you could become no Christian, or you could turn to the living God and, like silence before King Herod, you could not answer a word and just wait it out. And I did. I waited. I let it go until one day the same pastor came back and apologized. Now, years later, when I brought up the subject, of course, no, I don't remember that. Yeah, I know, you know, I got it. We get it. That's it. It's over with, done. Forgiven. But that's the point I'm trying to make. You can't fight unrighteousness by trying to prove you're right. You have to remain silent and let God reveal the facts. You can't touch Donald Trump as president. You really can't. He is solidly in place to do what he wants to do and chooses to do as he does until he so overwhelms the people that he hangs himself by his liberality, thinking that he can get away with murder, like he said, and then actually trying to do it. We're told that we now have American blood on his hands. He's already sent people out into Yemen to die. Oh, it was, you know, a military action. It was military being sent out to do what he wanted them to do, but it was still, nonetheless, blood on his hands. Would you be willing to obey Donald Trump's order to go somewhere today? Would you be willing to obey to march into the Valley of Megiddo in the name of America because Donald Trump sends you there? Would you be willing to fight for the right of the Antichrist because you received orders to do so? You see, there's a reason why God says, and then shall he speak unto them in his wrath and vex them in his sore pleasure, displeasure, because God ain't happy. There should be that fear of the Lord that we should always examine ourselves to see if we're in the faith. Just like me worried about my salvation and my relationship at times when people were lying or exaggerating or circumventing or telling falsehoods. Now, later on in life, I learned that, you know, a lot of people used to kind of burn me after a while. Matter of fact, I get burned more by Christians than anyone else I've ever met. I don't get burned by non-Christians, mostly, although recently I did, you know, when I was in Alaska working for a millionaire. But millionaires, they're working for money, so of course, I made them a lot of money, I got burned. But the point is this, you will find that you can't put your trust in God, I mean, gods of men. You can't put your trust in kings. You can't put your trust in America. You can't put your trust in your church, your pastor, your elder, your deacon, anyone else, but you put your trust in the Lord. Because you see, God can make that same pastor, that same deacon, that same church, that same country, that same nation, that same king, that same president, turn his heart around and make it work out for you to the best. Now, I'm not going to say that Donald Trump's going to get saved. I have my personal doubts, but I have to teach and preach that saving someone is God's department, and it's not mine. Mine is to present the gospel that, hey, anyone can get saved. You know, Jesus said, but look how hard it is for a rich man to get saved. It's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than a rich man to be saved. And that just simply meant that he can't give up his riches. Yet we are told later Zacchaeus gave up half of his riches to the poor. And the rest he was giving to something else to follow Jesus. So it is possible with God, but with man, it's impossible. Now, I have, you know, no problem knowing that, you know, no, I don't, you know, I can't lie to you with the, you know, knowledge that I have of people in general to say Donald Trump's a Christian now or is going to be. Yeah, I'm sorry. You know, maybe some great tragedy might cause him to understand God in a better way. You know, I don't want him, wish him ill health or good health or bad health. But whatever it takes, God, save the man. You know, if you got to kill the flesh to save the soul, God said he would do that. And Paul wrote a letter saying so. He said that there was a Christian in the body that they needed to cast him out and keep him out. And that if God killed him, hey, the man might be saved, but he'd be saved because he killed the flesh but saved the soul. kind of a radical, extreme way of looking at salvation. But I'm sure the man at one time had already commended himself to the Lord our God. But that's the problem with what we're seeing here in verse 6 or verse 5. Vexed them in his sore displeasure. So in verse 6, for the Lord knoweth the way of the righteous, but the way of the ungodly shall perish. And that I am thankful for. I don't have to prove myself. I don't have to reveal myself. I don't have to say how good I am or how bad I am. God reveals it. And if somebody doesn't see it, I don't care. You see, that's where I dare to say, I know whom I have believed, and he is able to do what I have committed unto him, even unto the day of salvation. For him I have committed my way. For him I have entrusted my soul, my being, my life, my wife, my everything, that he can take care of, and I cannot. That way, whatever the results are, is his will being done unto me, and being done through me, and being done for me. Not because I'm going to always be blessed, but rather, I will have passed the test of knowing anything that comes my way, I give it back to God that day, and I commit it unto him. For if we commit our ways unto the Lord, then he shall bring it to pass. If we trust in the Lord, then he would direct our path. If we would but lean not into our own understanding, then we would know the wisdom that God has for us. But the problem that mankind has is trying to put his understanding on top of God's plan, and that cannot happen. It will bring a man to destruction, even as we see the President of the United States self-destructing. Therefore the ungodly shall not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. Can't do it. I'm sorry. I can no more be a part of the administration than I can say that Hitler was a Christian, though he claimed to be, that his appointed generals were Christians, and they claimed to be, that the Christian pastors in Germany at the time of the Holocaust were Christian in their actions of ignoring what was going on and not saying a word. That's not Christian. God will hold them accountable, and he has. They're gone. Germany suffered one of the greatest, most miserable, humiliating defeats of all time. And to this day is still suffering for it. The reality of what we're saying here is something pretty simple. It is that the ungodly manifest themselves in a peculiar and particular way. It doesn't take a genius to figure out that, hey, if Jesus was a refugee, because he had to go to Egypt and running for his life, hey, in America, Christians will be running for their lives soon enough if Donald Trump has his way. Because Christians will stand for the truth. Christians will stand up for the right. Christians will stand up for the beaten down, the downtrodden. We will say with the Statue of Liberty, give us your naked, give us your poor, give us your helpless, hopeless, and refugees. Because we won't put up with it for too long. Sooner or later, conscience sake causes Americans to rise in a way that presidents don't see today much often, because they aren't that stupid to put themselves into such jeopardy as Mr. Trump has in doing things that are anti-Christian, anti-American, and that are against the principles that God had inspired men of God and men of the world and businessmen in the time that this nation was founded. And they all came together to say, look, the only good business is God's business, and the only God business we can do is if we take our business to him and allow him to lead us in a way that will make every man able to seek life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, not just a few men. And even then, they compromised and kept slaves. They compromised and lied about what they were doing. You see, that's where we can't be in the ungodly, but the righteous will make right choices, because that's what righteousness means. It means that God will impute to you. He will put upon you, he will put within you, and he will choose to make you righteous by imputing righteousness unto you for faith in his Son. You have to be in and involved with Jesus as the Son of God, the Son of Man, to have righteousness imputed unto you. Because when you stand before God, you're going to have some kind of righteousness. And if it's your own, you're going to hell. If it's Jesus' righteousness imputed to you, you're going to heaven. It's a pretty simple foundation, but it's a reality that's going to affect every single man, woman, and child individually. And he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of waters that bringeth forth his fruit in his season. His leaf shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. You know, I kind of like that. Prosperity, pastors and wealth coaches and God knows how many other false teachers, false doctrines, and false theology is out there. I see enough of it. But if you came over my house, you might say that I look prosperous in some ways. You might not say I'm a rich man, but you wouldn't say I'm a poor man. But in reality, I am a poor man. I have, as it were, purchased everything from used stores, sometimes from a new store, but it had to be, God knows, on sale in a ridiculous way. We have limited ourselves in the ability to buy and purchase things because we have chosen, my wife and I, to be missionaries here in Utah to Salt Lake City and to her own family as she is a missionary to them and as I am a missionary to the world at large. I've been called a missionary at large, laid hands on by several churches, including Calvary Chapel, several, including Foursquare churches, and including some other churches. They keep saying, well, we don't know what to do with you, but God knows He does, so we'll make you a missionary at large. Well, God bless you, be at peace, go. How do you want to get rid of me? Well, just lay hands on me and send me out. Don't give me money, honey, because you know what? I don't take it. But really, when God called me into the ministry, then He ordained me, He commissioned me, He called me, and then I went out and got the license, so don't go there, you know, trying to say, well, is He really ordained? Yes, I did, because unfortunately, I didn't plan on any kind of tax-exempt status. I won't. I didn't plan on doing marriages, because frankly, I think a marriage, you better be willing to stick with that couple all the way through till they die, if you're going to marry someone. Because if you marry them, you better bury them, because they better be together by the time you're done, because you committed your name to their marriage. So guess what? My marriage counseling, it's some serious biz. I don't have a problem whether I would marry a homosexual couple, heterosexual couple, a Christian couple or not. Most Christians can't survive 5 minutes with me. Are you going to serve Jesus? You know, is your wife most important or is Jesus? I mean, come on now. You know, reality is, no, people aren't coming to me to be married because I ain't letting them off the hook. They got to perform in order to marry. You know, it's an honor and a privilege to do something in the name of God, but I'm not doing anything that's going to commit my trust in you so that you could perform what you're doing, you know, and I know you're a sinner, you know, supposedly being married by me, because I'm saying I put my stamp seal of approval that God is going to keep this together and you guys are going to work it all out. Heck no! My personal experience, I've been through divorce. Ah, baby, you really got to go jump through a lot of hoops before I would ever dare or someone would dare to come to me to say, hey, we really thought about it and prayed about it. God wants us to come to you to be married. Ha! You got some discipleship to do. And it won't be 1 year. You better might as well mark off your calendar, man. You got a whole bunch of things to follow through. And yeah, that's the way it is. Because when I'm going to put my name on it, I'm going to make sure. And that's what God does. Did you know that? God doesn't just say, hey, take my name and run with it. No, God says, if you're going to call me Christian, here's what you are going to do. You are going to die to yourself and you're going to live unto me. If any man come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross and follow me. For whosoever seeks to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake, my name's sake, will find it. You see, God treats His name serious, even if you don't. There are a lot of people call themselves Christians, and I got people all the time coming up to me and say, hey, brother, and I don't answer them, because I'm not your brother. I'm not your sister, I'm not your mother, and I'm not your pastor. I am a preacher that is telling you that, hey, you've got a mother, a brother, and a sister, and a pastor that are doing the will of God. Those are my mother, my brother, my sister, my pastor, even my wife. If my wife isn't doing the will of God, I tell her, look, you know, you could be replaced. I don't tell her that quite that bluntly. Okay, yes, I do. She'll come out of that door right now and say, yes, he does. You know, he's, matter of fact, he's a jerk. And I am about that. Because you see, when you tell me you're a Christian, you better be a Christian. Because I'm not calling you brother. I'm waiting and watching. I've had brothers that have stabbed me in the back. But I've had brothers that have exceeded anything I've ever been with Jesus. You see, I know whom I have believed. I don't need to have someone try to tell me, we believe in. No, we don't. I believe in Jesus. I don't know what you do. And that's the reality of where I'm at. You know, I'm not saying I'm excluded from the body of Christ. I'm included, but not by your choice, by what God has chosen to make me a part of and where I belong in the body of Christ. But that's the fact of why we say, Jesus himself, in teaching his disciples, they came to him and said, hey, look, your mom and your dad, I mean, your mom and dad, your dad's dead, but, you know, your mom and your brothers and your sisters are all here. You know, come on, let's go meet them. And he says, no, wait a minute, you got it wrong. These are my mother and sisters and brothers, but he who does the will of God, these are my mothers and brothers and sisters. Because, you see, at one time, even Jesus' own mother and Jesus' own brothers and Jesus' own sisters were trying to stop him from going to Jerusalem to die. And yet that was what he was born for. They didn't want him going anywhere near Jerusalem. They even went ahead of him without him to stop him. And he still managed to get there before them. So you see, when you do the will of God, you are my brother. I may not call you that, but God will. But when you don't do the will of God, you're no more my brother than you are children of the Most High God. You're doing Satan's will. And that's the problem with Donald Trump. I can't call him brother. He's not my brother. He's not a Christian. He's a man that is into business. He's serving Mammon, the god Mammon, but he's serving Mammon. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law doth he meditate day and night. I love that one. You know, I always crack up when I think about it, because it always brings me back to my wife. My wife, one time, she probably hates this story and probably hates me telling it, but, you know, I tell it anyways. I was like, fits. But she asked me, she said, you know, I asked her once, I said, well, is there any time that you don't think? She said, yeah, lots. And I thought, huh. I mean, now I believe a lot, you know, I don't believe this is only true of my wife, by the way. I got to clarify this so that you don't get the wrong impression. Just because she's a blonde doesn't mean she doesn't have a thought. No, she thinks all the time. It's just, the point is, a lot of people can go to that place where they don't have a thought. They just don't think. You know, I mean, I'm not going to say it's Gentiles, but maybe it is. I mean, maybe all Gentiles don't think at some point in time. I don't know, but I know I'm thinking all the time. I think in my sleep. I think when I'm awake. I think, you know, day and night about God. You know, I really am. Lord, you know, I'm kind of thinking about that. You know, I was like, well, that guy really, you know, blistered me, you know, kind of beat me up. It's like, go get him, Lord. You know, I mean, I'm no different than you are. Hey, you were in my house. Don't take a cup of cold water from me, buddy, because guess what? That psalm says, if I give you a cup of cold water, fiery coals are over your head. I'm sinful. I'm carnal. I have those urges. Now, I don't do it in the Word on the internet because, obviously, that would cause me condemnation. And I'm personally, I believe in, you know, a little bit of self-defense. Like, I don't need to make any more mistakes and bring, you know, condemnation on myself or any more, you know, teaching lessons or, you know, object lessons, because I don't like pain. And God teaches through pain and suffering a lot. And you'll suffer your own consequences and learn from them. You will. Not someone else is going to take it for you. You're going to get it. Oh, you'll be saved, but you'll still pass through fire. So the reality of what this is saying is that, do you think about it? And that's what part of our ministry is all about at Vidigo Church. It always has been. Think. Think of how long distance effect whatever you're saying, teaching, preaching, acting, doing, or becoming. Think of the short-term effect, whatever it is, whatever it was, whatever it shall be. Think of the immediate effect. What are you doing? Stupid? You don't turn left on a right, or turn right on a left, or turn, you know, into oncoming traffic. That's stupid. The same thing is true about the Spirit, and the things of the Spirit, and the Word of God. You don't go against the grain when God says no, and you're living by His name. If He really is supposed to be God, He's supposed to be able to lead you, guide you, be God to you. Because if He's not, then you know what the problem is. You. God said He would do all these things. You know, that's the part I just don't get about Christians, you know. They always tell me, well, we're just not like you. We got our own relationship. Well, good. Is it anything like God leading? Well, no. We read and then we, you know, apply it and then we, you know, work it out and then, you know, we adjust it here and finagle it there and make it apply here. And, you know, it didn't mean it that way, but He meant it this way. Really? Sounds like your God is your God, meaning you are God. Not your God is a God, but you are God. Well, I never thought of it that way. Yeah, I know, because you weren't thinking. It's called stinking thinking, and I hear it all the time. And that's the reality of where we have to remind ourselves, again, always in this ministry, back to Proverbs 3:5-6 and James 1:5. Are we leaning in our own understanding? Do we interpret the scripture, or do we apply and let the Spirit of God apply to us personally the scripture? I don't take the scripture and throw it out at somebody else. You know, I mean, you've heard me talk about Donald Trump, but it applies to all of humanity. I've said Donald Trump is this way, and I'm able to be judged by the same measure with which I'm judging the man. Because if I'm going to call upon the name of the Lord, then I must follow the name of the Lord, not follow edicts that I decide are in the best interest of Christians. Sorry, doesn't work that way. And now the Christians are finding out they may have sold their soul to Donald Trump in order to get a president who will appoint, quote-unquote, a Supreme Court nominee that will agree with them about abortion. But what price did you pay? My God, you led the whole nation into heresy. You're leading the whole nation into damnation is what you're doing, because you're supposed to be the salt, not advocates of a personal interest. No matter how righteous your cause is, it's not righteous if you're sacrificing your relationship with Jesus for a cause. Blessed is the man that walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. And that's our last verse, because we've read it backwards. At the end of it, it says, kiss the Son, lest he be angry. Well, at the end of it says, blessed are all they that put their trust on him. And at the beginning of it says, blessed is the man that walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, or standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the way of the scornful. Are you getting the picture here? The blessed isn't about the money, honey. It's not about the goods, dude. It's not about the street, Jack, you know. But it's about blessed and being blessed by God. Meaning that, blessed are all they that put their trust in him. Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. But this happens to be Psalm 1, 12. And then at the beginning, as we're reading, blessed is the man that walks not in the counsel of the ungodly. Why are we dealing with an ungodly man? That's the point. Don't. Nor standeth in the way of sinners. Get out of the way. They'll run you over. Do you really think that you're going to stop a man who no one has said no to from doing what he has to do because he wants to do it? He's going to attack you. He's going to crucify you. He's going to come after you no matter who you are. He'll probably come after me, you know, and audit me or whatever me, you know, because of things I post. I mean, that's the way this millionaire is. I worked for a man that did the same thing, and he came the same way. He even fired me more than once, I think. No, I think he fired me only once. And then I quit on him 3 times. And the 3rd time, I never came back. Because I gave him an opportunity, and I warned him, look, you pull these stunts, and I'll quit. You know? So he pulled it, and I quit. He did it again, and I quit. And the 3rd time, it was about a year later, you know, after I'd been there a year. He pulled it, and I quit and left and never looked back. And he said to me, which is a foolish thing to say because I've had other people say it, you'll be back. And I was like, no, I won't. And I never did. And the man now is broken, beaten, suffering, miserable, lost his money, lost his health, lost his wealth, lost his power. Even as Donald Trump is going to be miserable, the more he gets, the more he's going to demand, and the more he wants to be in charge of the land. And it ain't going to happen. God will remove him. Nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. Now, some people think that I'm scornful. I don't mind you calling me that. You know, he scorns the president. Or he scorns the, you know, pastor who makes a mistake. You know, he doesn't go to them in private and in secret. Because the pastor posted all these, you know, hateful things on there, and he confronted that hate right there on the internet, where we know that as soon as it's posted, 10,000 people can see it. So he posts right there behind it so that the 10,000 can see that too. He should have just let it go and let all 10,000 people be deceived. Well, I guess I'm scornful, but I have a reason why. But really, scornful means more than what you think. It means that there is no restitution available. There is no adamation of realization of the fact that the person can look at it and examine themselves and say, well, you're right. Because I'll look down and, you know, at every time somebody says something to me about, well, you know, I don't think you should do that. And I'll look at them and go, well, I'm glad you don't think so, but did you pray about it? Now, really, what I do before I say, did you pray about it, is that I look at what was written and I say, well, either they're misinterpreting or I'm really way off base. So I ask, you know, God, where is it? What is it? Where am I going? How am I being? What is it that is wrong here? show me. And I expect God to, and he does. And so usually within a context of a few repartees back and forth, the person comes off with evil or some ridiculous statements that are just out of left field. Satanic, because it whispers in his ear. And so he posts it. Scorn is not that. Scorn is something else. Scorn is when you have no justification for the statements you're making and you're deriding someone worse than sarcasm. You're making it to where it is attacking their personal character and everything about them. For instance, scorn was used on Donald Trump's son. And as it should have been, everyone came to Donald Trump's son's defense. They refused to allow people to do that. And I, God bless them, every single one of them that did the same. You do not attack scornfully someone. You attack someone, if you're going to attack them, by God saying, look, do this. Now, obviously, I present things that feel like I'm attacking them. In reality, I'm telling them to think about it. This is what you're doing. This is what you are. You think about it. If you're not, great. Ignore it. Because if it's not conviction of the Holy Spirit, then you don't need to worry about it. But if it is, you need to worry about it. And that's why the blessed is so important. Because it says, oh, how happy.
Oh, how happy you have made me. Oh, how happy you have made me.
Hey! And my wife's sitting there in the other... By the way, while I'm out here doing this, my wife has to put up with all this while she's in the bathroom or the bedroom, whatever. Fortunately, I think she has her little, you know, like Walkman or whatever it is, you know, like a computer thingy, you know, that she can play with. But in the meantime, you know, it's like, wrap it up. She's got to come out sooner or later. I just told her, hey, walk by. I don't care. I'll say something about it. She knows. Yeah, I know. That's why I don't. But the point being is this. God wants to make you, oh, how happy. He wants you to kiss the Son. He wants you to be glad in the one who has made you, who has called you, who has told you, don't get involved in this stuff. Look at the backward masking and then look at the forward masking. I mean, I probably should read it forwards once. Because you know this, the reason why I use the backward masking and read them backwards, because you already know the scripture forwards. You know it very well. Some of you memorize it. Some of you are like, you know, whatever. Oh, wow. You know what I did was that I jumped from Psalm 2 to Psalm 1. See, I was going to read the Psalm 2, but I went out of order. I went from, then he speaks unto them in this wrath and let them in his way, and then I jumped over to blessed is the man on Psalm 1. Well, guess what? That was wrong. So, let's go back, and it says, so let me clarify. I made a mistake. I was wrong. Praise the Lord. I don't know what God intended, but, you know, we went up from verse, in case you're wondering, you can rewind this tape, but we went from verse 5, reading it backwards, of Psalm 2, and jumped over to verse 6, which is interesting, of Psalm 1, and then did that. So if you rewind, just rewind our backwards things, go backwards some, so that you can find where we're going to be right now. Because we're going to go from what we read. We read verses, all of Psalm 1, included it in Psalm 2, which made a perfect balance, because one started with blessed and one ended with blessed, but that's not the reality. We left out four scriptures that we're going to read now and apply. So you understand that? If not, rewind, replay, and you'll understand what I'm saying. I made a mistake. I jumped from verse 5 in reading and then went over to Psalm 1 and read it backwards. Now we're going to pick back up in Psalm 2. Verse 4, and I'll use that because I hate using them, but this time I'll use it so you know where we're at. 2, 4, 6, 8. Who do we appreciate? The Spirit of God, the Spirit of God. Yay! Because he can make sense out of this. Anyways, so now that we're into, I'm blushing. Now that we're in Psalm 2, verse 4, it says, he that sitteth in the heavens shall laugh. The Lord shall have them in derision. And I love it. How better to appropriately make the scriptures fit than the laugh? I mean, come on now. God made this in not derision, but laughter. To be joy-filled, to be joyful, to be blessed. I can laugh at my own mistakes because I know in a way it's like, wow, Lord, when I think about this later, what did you really mean by all that? I got to re-examine this, putting them together. But, you know, for you, it's like, oh, I made a big mistake. You know, you kind of went out of context. That's not the way the numbers go, and that's not the way the song goes. Well, those were added, so just so you know, numbers and letters and chapters and verses are all added. It's really written kind of in a long thing. But anyways, we won't go there. That sounds like an excuse anyways, but I've taught that subject before in Bible studies. But really, I like that because it says, he that sits in the heavens shall laugh. The Lord shall have them in derision. It means that he's going to laugh at them, but he's going to have them in derision, which means that they are going to look so stupid, so foolish, so ignorant. I personally think of what I've seen of Donald Trump's in his choices, and you know, I have to laugh about it because it just is totally insane. Makes no sense at all. I mean, in an evil way, yeah, but not in any other way that I can make sense of, but that's okay. The Lord said he would laugh because he's being used and he doesn't know it. Even as we are and we don't know it, we're pawns in a way with a big celestial game of chess that Job details for us to see that God and Satan sometimes have chess and we're just the pawns in it. Boy, ain't that a mess of your theology. So now in verse 3, let us break their bands asunder and cast away their cords from us. And that's where the reality of what I have said from the beginning is, you cannot support evil. I don't care when you tell me that I have to support the laws of the land. No, I don't. The laws of the land can be in Nevada and say that I can prostitute myself and sleep with a prostitute, and the reality is, no, I can't. That's a law of the land. The law of the land says I could go over to Colorado and smoke pot, and the reality of standing before God is, no, I can't. Don't tell me I have to support the presidency when evil is manifested by the edicts with which he is using and doing. Because my citizenship is in heaven. I am a stranger to this land I am passing through. I have reckoned my flesh dead, as Hebrews said. And I know that my body no longer is living according to this citizenship that it once was, being born here in this land. But rather, my citizenship has been confirmed in heaven. And I'm just a stranger to this world and its ways. I am not a child of Satan anymore. I am a child of God. That means you are not an American. You are heavenly bound. You are citizen of God. You are kids' kingdom. You know, kids of the kingdom is what we used to say. You are a child of God, a son or a daughter of God. You're not an American. Sorry, wrong idea. Quit the salute, quit the Pledge of Allegiance. That's false. Just reality, letting you know. We Jews figured that one out a long time ago. It says, don't swear about anything. And it went ahead and sweared anyways. And Jesus warned them, don't swear by the temple. Don't swear by the, you know, the altar. Don't swear by this or that or the other thing. You know, because you can't even make one hair of your head grow longer. You know, what are you swearing for? You don't know what you're doing. Still the same today as it was then. And so breaking our bands asunder means don't do when it's wrong to do. Period. Sorry. Doesn't apply to me. Presidential edict? No. That's it. The kings of the earth set themselves and rulers take counsel together against the Lord and against his anointed, saying. And really, reading this backwards, I like it leaving it at saying because, make sure I got them in order. Yeah. Saying. Because really, that's what it does. The kings do take counsel. They do get together. They do look at, how can I get the Christian vote? Well, I'll say I'm a Christian, I'll go to church. Okay. And so they do. They never talk about Jesus. They never share what their relationship is with Jesus. They never talk about the Bible or things from the Scriptures, unless it's a professional speech written for them. They never exemplify having the need or the personal relationship that says, I want a Lord over me. I want someone to take over for me. I want to give my life over to the Lordship of Jesus Christ. I am a sinner saved by grace. I want God to take over. No. They say things and think things and do things to get the vote, to get the popularity, to get the people with them, to get what they want when they want, how they want it. Sorry. Donald Trump decided, hey, I'm going to be a Jew for a while, you know, so put on the kippah, you know, and my kids will be a Jew, you know, my kid married a Jew, so they're all Orthodox, so hey, I like to be participating with them. Oh, but then I want to come over here and let the, you know, people anoint me and appoint me as King Cyrus. I'll go for that, sure, no problem. Never mind, I'm King Saul. Hey, what can you say? God appoints and chooses, not man appoints. But the reality is, are you being a king? Are you getting together and figuring out ways to get around the Lord, to get away from the Lord, to get away from being directed by God today, to being the abject, absolute monarchy you are of yourself? Or have you already given your crown over to the King of Kings and Lord of Lords? Why do the heathen rage and the people imagine a vain thing? Well, I know why. I know why. Because Jesus is coming. You see, it's going to get worse. The heathen aren't just going to rage. They're going to rail. They're going to assemble. They're going to fight. They're going to bite. They're going to be like dogs that have been starved, and now they're set free to go and chew on and fight and attack anything that's in their way. And that's what Donald Trump has said he would do today. When someone disagrees with me, I come after them with everything I got. Wow. Welcome to the presidency. You get the picture? He doesn't say we, like the royal we that the kings use and all that. He says I. He says I will make America great. I will make, and then, oh, by the way, we can do it together. But I will do it. Yeah. I get it. The saddest thing in heaven, the greatest tragedy on earth, is for any soul to lose its way and to wind up in hell. And the fact is, we're not told that we would lose our way. We're told that we never found the way if we go to hell. If we go to hell, we are told that it's because we did not choose today to listen to God, to hear from God, to speak to God, to seek God, to let God be God, to let Him direct us, to let Him be the object of our affection, to let Him have His way, His will, and His person to show us what we need to do to be saved. That's what gets you to hell. You've chosen not to obey. Bottom line. Now people say, well, which of the commandments do you choose to obey? Well, I choose to obey God. Well, which is that one? The one He told me. Well, which one is that? Well, it's not 10. It's 1. God. In the beginning, God. And that's it for me. What God says goes, and that's it. I'm done. Hey, if He says that, listen to my son, then now I'm listening to Jesus, because God said, this is my beloved son in whom I am well pleased. Listen to Him. This, Him, not your 10 commandments, not your Old Testament laws, not your ceremonial laws, not Levitical, not Talmudic, not reasoning, not logic, not drash, not systematic theology, Jesus. Let me tell you that clearly, because we're being serious. Jesus. Listen to Him. In Him, I am well pleased. Not be in Him and I'll be well pleased with you. Not make it like an action of faith that I just believe that I'm in Jesus. No. We do say that religion is a part of the relationship. You can't have one without the other. Your religion is to follow Jesus. Your religion is to have a relationship with Him. Your religion sets the foundation so that you will have a relationship for Him and with Him, because He is the one who initiates religion in you to go and seek Him in the first place. Seek the Lord while He may be found. And He said, come to me, because the door will be closed. Salvation is nigh. But I got news for you. When the rapture happens and they close the door, it don't mean that there's going to be a great revival next. It means that you're going to die or you're going to live. And if you live in the great tribulation, you're going to hell. Because you have to die for your faith literally in order to prove that you're not going to follow Satan and the false prophet and the false Messiah and the false world system and all the other garbage that's going on down the world. Money. So do you want to live for God today and serve Him and follow an easy way? Or do you want to do it the hard way? I mean, literally, if you try the hard way, you won't make it. You really won't. Because if Chuck Smith said it this way, if you can't live for Him now, you won't die for Him later. But if you find yourself there, and this, you watch this video and you're in the Great Tribulation, you need to die for Him. Don't take things. Don't do things. Just know that, you know, you got to do what you got to do. What God told you to do from the very beginning. Follow Jesus. So really, in messing this up, still, in bringing it back to the place and understanding, we not only have the why, we have the what and the wherefore. So, all I can say to you is, today, hey, walk away from the government. Really. Walk away from Donald Trump and his gyrations, obfuscations, lies, deceit, corruption, you know, games, whatever it is that he's the man is all wrapped up in. Walk away. Walk away from your own church today. Walk away from your wife, your kids, your dog. I'm sorry, you don't need to walk a dog and talk to God. You're not talking to God when you're walking your dog. 9 times out of 10, you're watching where the dog poops and scooping it up with your little handy-dandy, you know, little glove. No. Separate yourself unto God today for at least a minute or two and let him have his say. Because if he has something to say, he'll speak to you. If he's got nothing to say to you, I would worry. I would be concerned, and I'd ask God, God, you sure you don't want to tell me something? You know, repent, or you love me, or, you know, follow Jesus or something? But God, don't you want to say